Thank you very much for the kind presentation, and also thank you for giving me the opportunity to be here and share with all of you these preliminary results. I have to confess that probably one of the things I enjoy more during my young career is to have the possibility and the opportunity also to work in a multidisciplinary way and to somehow try to see and to solve the same problem from different point of view. And I fully agree with the previous presentation that actually is the way to work. As previously mentioned, the main goal of my presentation today is to, or was to identify interacting genes and biological pathways related with feed efficiency in pigs using existing genetics approach. I think that we are all probably agree that feed efficiency is very important trait for the economical sustainability of pig production, and that's why we are interested in that particular topic. To do our study, we use phenotypic and genotypic data that was generated at, in Spain during the LeapGen project, and basically we use 349 Duroc pigs. And for all that speak, we have several phenotypes related with traits associated with feed efficiency, growth and fat deposition, and meat qualities as well. In today's presentation, we use only 11 traits. And for the pig, we also have the genotype information coming from the cystic cage. And basically, after the quality control and so on, we use in the study almost 31,000 markers. To apply the methodology we use is the association weight matrix approach. The association weight matrix was originally published in 2010, and basically the main particularity of this statistical approach is the fact that this is a multivariate, multi-trait analysis that combines the result coming from several GWAS across traits, in our case 11 traits, with the novel of a transcription regulator, so he incorporates the information coming from transcription factors within a network theory framework. From the graphical point of view, basically everything starts with the genome-wide association analysis, so you run the GWAS independently for each trait, and at the end you have two different matrices. The first matrix you have as many rows as markers, as SNPs, so here 31,000 SNPs, and as many columns and as traits. And the intersection between the row and the column in the first matrix is the p-value coming from the genome-wide association analysis. In the second matrix, the structure is exactly the same, but the difference is that rather than use the p-value, we use the estimate additive effect coming from the GWAS. Then, after applied a series of criteria for selection, we have the matrix that look like this here. And having the matrix, we use a PCIT, which is a software to infer gene-by-gene interaction. But here, rather than infer the gene-by-gene interaction using the expression of the gene, we use the estimation of the additive effect. And finally, one of the possibility you have with this kind of approach is to, I'm sorry for the quality of the picture, it's much better here, believe me. And basically the idea is to navigate throughout the network and identify the main regulators that drive, that have the higher number of connections with the lower overlapping. Doing that, you maximize the possibility to recover the main regulator of the network. After applying the approach, in our case, we use a target phenotype, the residual feed intake. I didn't mention before, but the residual feed intake was calculated as usual. It's the residual coming from a model that includes the feed intake, the average daily weight, the molecular body weight, as well as the bad fat thickness. So initially we select off the market that are associated with residual feed intake, then we explore the dependencies of the marker, and the idea is to take advantage of the genetic contribution of correlated traits, so we include other markers that even when are not associated with residual feed intake, are associated with at least other traits. And at the end, we have a matrix. We have 704 genes and 11 columns. And basically, from the 704 genes, we identified 49 regulator, 49 transcription factor, and here in the heat map that I want to show is the, that having this information, we can apply certain quality control, and it's expected that if the genome-wide, if the model of the genome-wide association analysis fit properly well the data, using the additive, estimated additive value from the GWAS, you can reconstruct in this cluster the physiological and the correlation relationship between the traits. For instance, here we can see that the residual feed intake and the food conversion ratio cluster together, as well as here, for instance, the trait related with the growth of the buffer thickness, average daily weight, and the trait here related with the meat quality, the saturated fatty acid, the polysaturated fatty acid, and the monosaturated fatty acids. Then, once we have the association weight matrix, the next step is to infer the interaction network based in the additive effect. And initially, the network looked like that, in which each node represents a gene, and the color of the node is proportional to the number of the connections within the network. And there are some tools that can be used to navigate throughout the network and estimate, for instance, the topological parameters of the network, identify the most connected genes within the network, as well as to do the functional analysis using either the CLUE-GEO or the Ingenuity Pathway Analysis. Also, it's possible to identify in silico a transcription factor binding size for the predicted target of the key transcription factor. And finally, that we did was to identify within the network the putative key regulators, and we can do that for the combination of duo, trios, or quartetos of transcription factors. And in today's presentation, I would like to use as one example to illustrate what can we do next, the best combination of transcription factor, and basically we identified three transcription factors that were co-associated with 399 SNPs. The transcription factor was the LX4, the POF2F1, and the TCF7L2. The first thing we did was check the literature, and we was quite happy when we realized that the free transcription factor has been associated with feed efficiency. For the first one, the TCF2 has been associated in two different studies with the residual flick intake and the meat quality traits as well, and also with the feeding behavior. This transcription factor is very important in the normal regulation of the pituitary hormone gland. Sorry, and as you may know, that the pituitary gland has a very one important role in the regulation of feeding, and this one is important for the regulation of the immune system as well. Then, in a first step, we was interested in see whether or not these 399 markers explain a proportion of the phenotypic variance for residual feed intakes and other feed efficiency related traits. And basically, that we did was to feed the model using the genomic relationship matrix and the method proposed by Yang in 2010. And we saw that the markers co-associated with the free transcription factor capture proportion of the phenotypic variant for the feed efficiency related trait, as expected, because the method was centered in the residual feed intake. The higher proportion of the phenotypic variant was captured for the residual feed intake. And in order to have one idea of how different is the proportion explained by the marker to the one we expect by chain alone, that we did was to select exactly the same number of markers by chains and repeat the analysis 3,000 times. And here we have the distribution of how look like the proportion of the phenotypic variant explained by the exactly the same number of markers, and as we can see, it's far away to the one we sought. Then we also was asked ourselves whether or not we can use those markers for predict the residual feed intake. And here, basically, that we did was a cross-validation, and we repeat the process 100 times. And for the accuracy of the residual feed intake prediction, here is interpreted as the correlation between the real value of the residual feed intake and the predicted value. The correlation was moderated, but certainly far away to the one we expect by chain alone, because here we did exactly the same. we repeat the analysis 100 times, selecting each time different validation and testing data set, and also the same number of random selected markers. The next question we have was to try to understand the biological process behind the DAT genes. And again, I'm sorry for the quality of the picture, but basically we ran the analysis and we see that most of the gene belong to biological process related with social and exploratory behavior, system, nervous system, immune system, and probably the most interesting observation here is that the core of the network, of this functional network, was related with function associated with glutamate receptor and the regulation of neurotransmitter. Glutamate is one of the most important neurotransmitters, and it's also has been documented that the glutamate have one important role in the regulation of feeding behavior. It's also interesting for us the overrepresentation of immune response, because in two previous studies using in this time transcriptome data, this is one study from INRA in Toulouse, and this one study from our team at Barcelona, and in both cases were studies doing multi-tissues analysis, and in both studies systematically the immune system is overrepresenting, and somehow that makes sense because the immunity, as probably all you know, have energy is really energy demand for the organisms, and we are really interested in to better understand the relationship between the immunity and the feed efficiency as well in posterior studies. So, a conclusion, we identified three transcription factors that may have one role in the regulation of feed efficiency in pigs. We saw that immune response appears to be consistently involved in feed efficiency related traits. Also, we identified some other biological functions that are at least interesting for us, as for instance, social behavior, the overrepresentation of gene associated with the neurotransmitter. What next? Well, we are ready. The same thing we would like to do it is to try to validate using one independent data set, because we already have evidence using the cross validation, but I personally believe that to have one independent data set would be much better. Also, one thing we are already doing is to integrate also functional information in the model, and by using a combination of a multivariate and univariate analysis, identified other candidate genes that were not identified using the association weight matrix, and for all that gene identified here in this study, and also coming from the integration of the liver and the gluteus medius tissues data, run a GWAS and see whether or not the use of SNP that are associated to the gene expression of the candidate gene could probably improve the genomic prediction of the trait. Doing that, I just want to thank to the project, as well as to the Marie Curie Action, which is the one who is paying my postdoc in Spain, and obviously all of you for the attention. Thank you.
Question. Is it the same in chicken?
What was your heritability of your residual feed intake?
Well, the heritability of the feed efficiency trait, including the residual feed intakes, vary between 0.2 or 0.5, depending of how it's calculated.
So can you then explain to me why your SNPs explain 51% of your phenotypic variants?
Sorry, again?
You say your SNPs explain 51% of your phenotypic variants, but your heritability is between 0.2 and 0.5.
Yeah, no, I'm referring to the heritability in the literature. I didn't estimate it from our data set.
Okay, but would you, looking at the two, would you think that it's quite high, the 51%?
Yes, we are agree that probably is overestimated, and actually, maybe it's overestimated, but certainly it's different to the one you expect by chain alone. And also, one other possibility, and actually if you go through the literature, you will find that if you estimate the components variance using the GCTA, based in the genomic method, probably it's tend to overestimate it. But we estimate it also using this approach and was higher, not as higher as the 51%, but was higher. Another possibility could be related with the structure of the population, because these peaks are coming from a population which was funded by six boars, Rainer? Five boars, and I think that 200 females, isn't it? Okay. So probably it's also a consequence of the trust of the population. That's why we want to validate it in independent data set.
Can we go back a couple of slides?
You yes,
have
this,
I think, with 10 columns and 507 rows or something. Or 700, yeah, that one.
Okay.
Now, if you look at the columns for FCR and RFI, you had those.
Okay.
They are not the same, yeah? They
look, no.
There is incomplete overlap, and that is good, because residual feed intake is net feed efficiency, and feed conversion ratio is gross feed efficiency, yeah? And I think you calculated your residual feed intake by adjusting for things like growth rate and fatness and so on.
Yes.
So, if you look at the difference between those two columns, then those genes, and who, how many are there? 700. Of the 704 genes that you have there, the genes that do appear in FCR and not in RFI, they should be related to growth rate or fatness.
Yes.
Do you find that?
We check the, because doing that you can also estimate the somehow the genomic correlation between the traits, and that we saw that it was that there is a positive correlation with intramuscular fat, and residual feed intake have a positive 0.21 is the value of the correlation, to be more specific. And also, I don't remember all the correlation value, but I can show you later because my computer is there. So. But yeah, yeah, we find some correlation.
I'm talking about the difference between those two columns.
Mm-hmm.
The difference between FCR and RFI.
Well, as you mentioned, they are not the same trait, so I don't expect there.
That's the point.
Yeah.
But the difference between those two. For example, in the FCR column, when you go up a little bit, there's a, no, no, down, close to the bottom, FCR, to the left, sorry.
The northern left.
Yeah, that one. FCR. There is a white spot. Yeah, there. Uh-huh. There is a white spot. And in the RFI, you have
a red spot.
A red spot.
Yes,
so
yes,
there
here.
Is a big difference there.
Here.
Yeah. So I'm wondering if those genes that play a role in RFI, but not in FCR, they should be related to the traits that you are adjusting for when you calculate the RFI.
I have to check it.
Yeah, that was the question. Do you find that?
No, no, I didn't check it.
Okay, good. We'll come back to it later.
Thank you.
You showed the R-square for those three, based on those 399 markers. I think it is more common what people nowadays do is that they have this selected set of markers, like your 399, and then to have the other 30,000-40,000 that you also have, to have them also as in a separate G matrix, and to have both of them. And then you also try to use that.
Yes.
Because in general, what people say, okay, well, let me get a much higher.
Yeah. Well, I did, but I it's not in this slide, but I can show you later also. The idea was to know the proportion of the phenotypic variant explained by the whole, all the SNPs, and then to know one idea of how different is to the one explained by the 399 SNP. I was thinking it was in this slide, but I'm sorry, it's not, but I have there.
Everything is in your computer.
Yes, yeah. Or in the call, I will show you later.
Then encourage you still to interact with you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.